keep your Mac, I'll pipe you to the sub as a bass singer. We'll have an actual bass singer in the congregation. So, he'll be leaving. Alrighty then.
Tell him to give us a thumbs up up there, brother. Tell him to give us a thumbs up, because I can't see it.
All right. Good morning, Hardison, this morning. Let's get a song book and turn to 141, and let's stand as we sing "He Hideth My Soul."
Oh, wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. A wonderful Savior to me. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock, where rivers of pleasure I see. Shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of His love, and covers me there with His hand, and covers me there with His hand. A wonderful Savior is Jesus my Lord. He taketh my burdens away. He holdeth me up and I shall not be moved. He giveth me strength as my day. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of His love and covers me there with His hand and covers me there with His hand. With numberless blessings each moment He grounds and fills with His fullness divine. I sing in my rapture, oh glory to God, for such a Redeemer as mine. He hideth my soul in the cleft of the rock that shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of His love and covers me there with His hand, and covers me there with His hand. When clothed in His brightness, transported I rise to meet Him in clouds and the sky. His perfect salvation, His wonderful love, I'll shout it with millions on high. He hideth my soul in the depths of the rock and shadows a dry, thirsty land. He hideth my life in the depths of His love and covers me there with hand and covers me there with his hand.
Amen. Well, sure it's good to be in God's house this morning. Good special day of baptism service. I'm excited, and I assume you're excited. It's been a few years since I got to baptize somebody, and I believe it's been a little while since there's been water in the pool, so we're mutual in this. But I'm excited. It's good to see everybody here that's here today. Just good to be in God's house with our brothers and sisters in Christ. Brother Vern, how about if you would pray for us this morning, please, brother?
Dear Father, come to you this morning. Father, thank you so much for being able to be here, Lord, this morning. We thank you for everyone who's here, Father, to go home and say it's been good to be in the house of the Lord. We just thank you so much for it. Father, I pray that you'll be with the preaching now and impress it on our hearts that we can take something from here to the world as we go out and tell about you. In Jesus' name we ask you. Amen.
Amen. Thank you. You may be seated. I'm not going to bore you a lot of announcements. You've been reading them for 10 minutes on the screens and all, but I just want to mention this normal stuff through the week. Saturday morning, ladies meeting, 10:30, fellowship hall, men's meeting the 28th in church. At 9 o'clock, that remains to be seen. If we decide to bring shovels that are later or biscuits at 9:30, but we'll let you know between 9 and then, though. But of course, baptism service this morning. The young people are going to stay out today. I say young people. Brother Theus got excited when I said young people staying out. He gets to stay out, right? But anyway, I'm talking about as far as children, junior church. I'm going to let them stay out today because my plan is to only preach till about 10:45, 11:45 that would be, and get started with the baptism service and all that. And I wanted the ones that have been baptized to be in the service up to that point. So rather than split them, we decided them to do that. Appreciate the workers. I didn't let them know last night, and I should have. I didn't let them know, but they're prepared in advance for next week now, though. But anyway, certainly be in prayer for the Odom family. The service is tomorrow here, and visitation 10. Most of you probably know by now, but visitation 10, service at 11. The burial will be in Perry. Will be a private burial with family, but they're going to leave, go down there, and come back here, and we'll feed them here. We'll take care of the, church will do the chicken and all that, but I know y'all been working that out as far as food and what, your plans toward that and all, but looking forward to that. I know it's kind of short notice, but that's obviously, that's a case where it is short notice. We don't have any control over that. But I think it's due and just for them to use the facilities and for us to feed them. 22 years of service here should never be forgotten. And I pray for Brother Rick. And all the conversations I've had with him so far, he's been a good morning. Good morning, Miss Natalie. We went to church together at Bethel when I was a little smart-mouthed teenager, and her boys were, Fred Faircloth is her son that did our plumbing repairs in back, but I was at her house a few months ago and asked her, I said, Miss Natalie, you were there at church meeting when I was a teenager. I said, was I really that bad and a bad teenager, just really smart-mouthed, as bad as I remembered I might have been? And she said I really wasn't that bad, but maybe she was just, I don't know if she's been honest or graceful, but anyway, Brother Rick, be remember Brother Rick, the conversations I've had, he's been really strong through it, and of course, Miss Jenny had suffered a while, and the suffering's no longer, she's with Jesus, and he was excited yesterday, he was talking about the songs they're singing, and the service and everything, he's excited, he said, Brother Jim, we're just going to worship, we're going to worship the Lord and make much of Jesus, and I don't remember exact verbatim what he said, but he voice cracked a little bit and all, and he said, I was her pastor 30-something years, so I'm doing her service. And man, I appreciate that. I respect that and honor that so much. But at the same time, he needs our prayers to do that. And also be praying for Brother Rick and all the family. And I don't know the rest of the family, but y'all do. But be praying for the family. And hopefully, I know some of you have to work and can't be here and all, but hopefully we'll be here in a good number to support and love that family tomorrow morning. Well, that's all I've got. We'll be just in a minute. Let's sing a song, brother.
As we continue, let's turn to page 459. 459. Like the woman at the well, I was seeking for things that could not satisfy. And then I heard my Savior speaking, draw from my well that never shall run dry. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up and make me whole. There are millions in this world who are craving the pleasures earthly things afford. But none can match the wondrous treasure that I find in Jesus Christ my Lord. Fill my cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. My cup, fill it up and make me whole. So my brother, if there's things this world gave you, leave hunger that won't pass away. My blessed Lord will come and save you if you kneel to him and humbly pray. My cup, Lord, I lift it up, Lord. Come and quench this thirsting of my soul. Bread of heaven, feed me till I want no more. Fill my cup, fill it up, and make me whole. As we continue singing, let's turn to page 629. And if you can stand, let's stand as we sing Mansion Over the Hilltop.
I'm satisfied with just a cottage below, a little silver and a little gold. But in that city where the ransom will shine, I want a gold one, that silver. In that bright land where we'll never grow old.
And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk on streets that are pure as gold.
Though often tempted, tormented and tested, and like the prophet, my pillow of stone. And though I find here a permanent dwelling, I know he'll give me a mansion my own. I've got a mansion or lonely, I'm not discouraged, I'm heaven bound. I'm just a pilgrim in search of a city. I want a mansion, a harp and a crown. I've got a mansion just over the hilltop, in that bright land where we'll never grow. And someday yonder we will never more wander, but walk the streets that are pure as gold.
Amen. You can be seated. Calvary, the day that Jesus died, would you have stood before the cross or over to one side? Would shame have filled your wandering heart for sins you'd often done? Would tears have flowed down on your cheeks as you beheld God's Son? Yes, a vision of Calvary is what we need today. A vision of Calvary, it seems we've gone astray. Remember how our Savior died, how darkness filled the land, and understand that through it all, it was as God had planned. If you had been at Calvary on that dreadful day, you could have heard the Lord for his accusers pray. 6 hours Jesus suffered there, hanging on the tree. In this we see the love of God, for he died for you and me. Yes, a vision of Calvary is what we need today. A vision of Calvary, it seems we've gone astray. Remember how our Savior died, how darkness filled the land, and understand that through it all, it was as God had planned. And understand that through it all, it was as God had planned. You'll turn your Bibles to Mark chapter 2 this morning. In Bible college, the subject came up of impromptu preaching. And the fellow made the comment that said that a lot of times people say they're impromptu preaching, but they're actually pulling an outline out of the back of their Bible and preaching something that they had planned, just not for the moment. And he called a fellow in the class. He said, "Brother Terry, get your Bible, turn to Hebrews chapter 6. If you know much about your Bible, probably one of the most discussed and disagreed passages of Scripture in the New Testament." He said, Hebrews chapter 6, verses 1 through 6. And he said, "I'm going to give you like 2 minutes to look at it." And in 2 minutes, he said, "Brother Terry, preach 5 minutes." And Brother Terry shucked the corn, man. He tore it up. He preached the Word of God with power. I mean, impromptu preaching. When he got through, Brother Tab said, "That's impromptu preaching, boys. Put on the spot." I said that, say that. That was an impromptu special. I hope it didn't hurt your ears too bad. But the truth of that song is written by a friend of ours, Ralph Smith and Eastman, but it's a good song there. We got too far from Calvary in our lives, hadn't we? We need a fresh look at Calvary. We need a fresh glimpse in our lives. And I think sometimes we get too straight from the cross, too far from realizing what our Lord and Savior did for our sins. And it's if we're not careful, we become comfortable in our sin. But when we look at old bloody Calvary, it's a reminder of what our sin cost our Savior and the price of our salvation. Mark chapter 2, I'm going to read one verse to start with. We'll go back and read a good portion of this. But I want to read Mark chapter 2, verse 17. Stand with me if you would, if you're able to, for one verse. And I will read the rest. If you're not able to stand, the Lord knows that, and I know that. Mark chapter 2, verse 17, the Bible says, "When Jesus heard it, he saith unto them, They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." You can be seated. Well, there's a lot of concerns in America. I don't know the latest on Israel, what's going on, if that's cooled down or heated up through the night and yesterday, but just a portion of the trouble of the world. I've got a lot of things to say about that subject, but I'm not going to say them right now. But pray for the peace of Jerusalem. And God have mercy on a country that turns their back on Jerusalem and on Israel. But let me move on. A lot of concerns in America today. And world terrorism. Child. Try to keep this mixed company appropriate. But child thievery and child slavery and sex trade, and I could say a lot more about that, kind of a hot topic with a movie out, The Sound of Freedom. I've not seen it. I've heard from the author a lot about it. Not directly from the author, just heard some comments, some things, but such a troubling time we live in. But there's the economy, the problems of the economy, inflation, all the things we face that we live with in our life. And when I talk about inflation, I'd have to talk about health care. And boy, if there's anything that's received the bitter end of inflation, it's health care. And the price of health care is not affordable, as some would have you to like it to say. A working class man can't afford insurance. If you can't afford insurance, you don't have money left to pay to go to the doctor bill with your deductibles. It's so expensive. And the price of that, it's just ridiculous. And we're not here about those things, but I say that to bring it out. Jesus says in here, he says, "They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance." I want to preach a few minutes on this subject, and on this subject this morning, God's health care. Well, God's got a plan that exceeds any plan man's ever had. And not only is he able to heal our bodies, but the more important matter, heal our souls for all eternity. So let's pray. Father, I pray that you'd help us this morning. God, I thank you for every single soul that's here today. God, I pray that you'd help us, Lord, that we'd be focused on the cross, focused on the death, burial, and resurrection. Lord, that we'd be considerate and think, Lord, of those that are be baptized today, Lord. Such a special day, God, and I thank you for this day. But Lord, here right now, God, I pray that you'd help me to preach truth. Lord, if there's one in here today that does not know you as Savior, God, how I pray you'd work mightily in their heart. God, to realize that you specialize in the lost. It seems like the worst cases you do the best with. God, help us today. Lord, help me to preach truth. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to read back through chapter 1 up to about that verse, our text, verse 17, and maybe make a few comments along the way. In verse chapter 2 of Mark, it says, "And again he entered into Capernaum after some days, and it was noise that he was in the house. And straightway many were gathered together, insomuch that there was no room to receive them, no, not so much as about the door, and he preached the word unto them." You know, it's kind of interesting thing there. Just want to point that out there, that he preached the word unto them. Keep in mind, this is very early in the timing of the New Testament in his earthly ministry. The New Testament had not been penned, so what did he preach? I don't know. Maybe the same that Philip did over there in Acts chapter 8 when, you know, the Ethiopian eunuch was there and he was reading from the book of Isaiah, and he said, "Is this man or some other man?" And said, Philip just kind of pulled up there and got up there beside him in that carriage and preached Jesus to him. Well, I don't know. He said he preached the word to him there, and it's just kind of interesting thought there to me that Jesus in the John chapter 1, verse 14 there talks about the word became flesh. So he's referred to as the word, the capital W word in there. And there, so Jesus preached the word. But the word preached Jesus. So you can look at it either way there, just a little interesting observance there. Let's move on along there. But he preached to him. He preached the word, and no doubt he probably preached the points of the law that would condemn them and show them their need of a Savior, and the pointing out of the Ten Commandments that would show that all come short of the glory of God and all have sinned. In verse 3, "And they come unto him, bring him one sick of the palsy, which was born of four, is carried by four there. And when they could not come nigh unto him for the press, they uncovered the roof where he was, and they had, when they had broken it up, they let him down through where, stop, y'all hold on a minute, let me get at a point where I can see what I'm trying to read. They let down the bed wherein the sick of the palsy lay. So they carried him in there, let him down through the roof. Y'all all know this story. When Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. Now, I wrote some years ago, I don't know how long ago, I wrote four men there, but I think I wrote a mistake. I think when he said, seeing their faith, when Jesus saw their faith, I'm pretty sure he probably was looking at the five there, the four that carried him and the one that was there that had that desire to go in, that he was there too, because he was there. He was one of the ones there as well. But and obviously they had faith that the Lord saw and were saved by a personal faith, right? But when Jesus saw their faith, he said unto the sick of the palsy, Son, thy sins be forgiven thee. But there were certain of the scribes now that rocked their boats when this one that they denied who he was, they had denied him as Messiah and certainly as the Son of God and God the Son. But when he went talking about forgiving sins, it was like, whoa, who's this guy think he is? And this comes up over and over through the Gospels. But it must have rocked their boats. They brought him, obviously having heard of the physical miracles, and Christ focused on the man's greatest need is sin. Verses 5 through 10 deal with this. Verse 6 says, "But there were certain of the scribes sitting there and reasoning in their hearts, Why doth this man thus speak blasphemies? Who can forgive sins but God only?" Well, you got your answer. You're looking at him. He was right there with you, forgiving the sins, God in the flesh. "And immediately when Jesus perceived in his sight that they were that so reasoned within themselves, he said unto them, Why reason ye these things in your hearts? Whether is it easier to say to the sick of the palsy, Thy sins be forgiven thee, or to say, Arise and take up thy bed and walk. And that ye may know that the Son of Man hath power on earth to forgive sins, he saith to the sick of the palsy, I say unto thee, Arise and take up thy bed and go thy way into thine house. Now, a lot could be said about that bed and take up thy bed. And there's a lot, but I don't want to focus on that part so much. But he dealt with the sin, but he also dealt with the sickness of that man, didn't he? And he dealt with that. And said, arise, take up thy bed and go thy way into thy house. And said, immediately he arose, took up the bed, and went forth and before them all, insomuch that they were all amazed and glorified God, saying, we never saw it on this fashion. But what a statement. That ought to be every time God moves in our midst, moves in the lives of those we love, whether it be in healing power, especially when it be in saving power, man, what a thought there. I never saw it like this before. And man, so many times through the New Testament, those miracles he did, I'm sure it's not recorded, but in that one little place that it said there, but it may be some likenesses to that in other places, but man, I'm sure there was those sitting around said, man, we ain't never seen it like this before. Man, we come to the house of God, we ought to be excited. We ought to be expecting God to do great things. We ought to come in, we're so used to, and I'm not talking about just Hardison Church USA, if we're not careful, we're so used to coming in, dragging in here. Whenever we can get here, we get here, we wait for the song later, but we know before he says it that we're going to stand for the first song, we're going to sit down after that one, then we may stand for the third one. We're probably going to stand to read the verse of scripture if it's Sunday morning, but we get so set in our routines, we come in here not excited about anything. And would to God that we come to God's house prepared, prayed up, excited to see God do great things, see God save an old wretched sinner. Hey, for somebody, maybe anybody, and sometimes it surprises you who it might be, that any of us, some of us might, the Lord might nudge your heart for something we've been struggling with. Man, with an old-fashioned altar, man, an altar call time, man, we'd be excited about the things of God, and we'd get in an altar crying before God, say, God, help me with this struggle, help me with this, forgive me with that and all. But we come in here sometimes just lackadaisical, feeling just kind of, oh, it's time to go to church today. We'll go to church and we'll sit down, we'll stand up, and we'll go through our routine, shake each other's hands, and, you know, go through our mechanical moves. Now, good to God, we come to the house of God with a heart for God and worship Him and come thirsting, hungering for the power of God in our home, in our church, in our lives, that would spill over into our homes. There ain't none of that in my notes, but it sure is on my heart. And immediately arose, took up the bed, and went forth before him, insomuch that all that were amazed glorified God, saying, we never saw it on this fashion. What like to every Sunday morning, every Sunday night, every Wednesday night, we go to the house of God to see God move in a way where we'd say, man, get back through the end of the service. Say, man, we ain't seen it like that before. And he went forth again by the seaside, and all the multitude reported unto him, and he taught them. And as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, sitting at the receipt of custom, and said unto him, follow me. And he arose and followed him. Well, would to God we'd have that kind of faith. Jesus said, do what I say, and we say, amen, praise God, let's do it. And it came to pass that as Jesus sat at meat in his house, many publicans and sinners sat also together with Jesus and his disciples. For there were many, and they followed him. And when the scribes and Pharisees saw him eat with publicans and sinners, oh my, man, he's holding righteous. What's he doing with all those folks of that caliber? What's he doing with them? Ain't he supposed to be out here with us righteous crowd, with us good folks, us good do-gooders? Ain't he supposed to be out here with us? And they said unto his disciples, how is it that he eateth and drinketh with publicans and sinners? When Jesus heard it, he said unto them, and I just hear it, I'm not trying to add to the Word of God, but I just imagine the thought that here he was dining with the ones that he came to save, and the self-righteous crowd called him out on that, and I can just hear the inflection of his voice. I don't even know how to say what I'm want to say here, but I can just imagine, and I'm not trying to add the Word of God, but I can imagine if just some thought of something like, y'all really need to listen to this. Y'all need to really listen to this. And Jesus heard it, he said to them, They that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick. I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. Now, does that mean he won't save those self-righteous folks? No, it don't mean it on their own. It means what he means by it, they don't, obviously don't need him, want him. They want him to stay in their box, not get in his world of repentance. And he knows that. He's wise enough to know those that are set in their ways, they're going to do what they want to do. And he's wise enough to know the hearts of those that simply hunger and thirst for the things of God. This health care that he offers, not a health care, I should have said soul care, maybe would have been a more appropriate title. But he talks about this need that they have. He says, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And I want to liken this for just a few minutes and talk about health care and kind of share some things with you. This health care that he came to offer the sinners, that he came for, let me read it again, to call the righteous, not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. That care that he's talking about, that change there, I'm using the word health care, but I want to say, number one, that health care is something that we really need in America. And I'm not talking about Affordable Health Care Act or anything like that. I'm talking about we need Jesus. And the wickedness, all the things we see when we go out those doors, sometimes we come in these doors, but when we go out those doors, all those things we see, we pick up newspaper. Well, I ain't picked up a newspaper in years, but we click on our news app or ever how you receive your news, whatever, and all the wicked things going on in this country. And I don't see how it's gotten the way it's gotten. I don't understand it. There's so many topics of sin now. I don't even know where we'd start, but it's just like in your face. If you watch any kind of TV program, sin is just promoted just like assuming everybody is about all the sin that they partake of. And I guess Brother Roloff would sit back and say, I told you so. I tried to warn you of that one-eyed monster years ago and y'all laughed at me. But man, it's just a wind in the world of the wickedness that we live amongst. And I'm going to tell you what, America's failing quick. We've already failed, I feel like. And I'm not anti-American. Don't misunderstand that. If your allegiance is to America more than it is to God, you need to get that right with God. My allegiance is my heavenly city and my heavenly Savior. But I'm American until I leave there, and I love America, but it's a shame, and that's why I'm so boiled inside with that, because I love America, but America is not what America used to be. We're in the process of losing this ground quickly. But there is a care of God that would help us in 2 Chronicles 7:14. If my people which are called by my name shall humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then will I hear from heaven and will forgive them, forgive their sin and will heal their land. And I know that's in its context dealing with Israel and the up and down fell and repentance and failure and repentance of Israel over and over again, but it sure applies to America today, doesn't it? It absolutely does. But this health care, boy, America needs Jesus. Man, I'll tell you what, it's a sad day that think about that I believe our land was started to be a base of sin worldwide missions out of. I believe that with all my heart. I believe that was the purpose of America. And we've become a place where wicked nations are about the place where they've been sending missionaries back to plant churches in America. Not only is that health care good for our nation, but that health care is good for our country. I mean, I said for our country, but good for our children. And I'm talking about our homes. Our children, I believe, are our greatest asset. They're not the church of tomorrow, they're the church of today. May not be in leadership positions today, but well, if we're not interested in, don't care about our children and young people today, there won't be any church tomorrow. You don't think it breaks my heart to go out there to the youth room and go in there? We're showing somebody, Brother Jared last week, we showed him around the property and showed him out there, and I took him up through there and went in there and just said, this just breaks my heart that 3 years ago they were 14, 15, I don't know how many, but a handful of teenagers, or a double handful of teenagers out there on Wednesday nights having their own service, and now it's just an empty room. Having worked with youth in two churches before I ever started pastoring, I still have a heart for teenagers. But I need help. And I'm not saying that necessarily to you, but to all of us. Boy, we got to reach folks and folks get saved and all that. I'm not going to put an ad in the paper saying I need a youth pastor. That's how you get pedophiles. I'm not going to put an ad in the paper saying we need a song leader at our church. I like to see the Lord work from inside and promote and all. I'm not saying a youth pastor couldn't come from the outside, but I think it's something we need to be praying about in the future, somebody. But I'll just be honest with you. I just love to have a young family that loves young people that's faithful to the things of God, that's got a heart for young people, that'll start doing some things with them, teach them in a Sunday school class, and do some things for me. Don't think that I don't care that we don't have teenagers anymore. We got really one here, and I appreciate that one. And I mean, I wish I had 25 more to work with and to help and all. But our children, our homes, this health care, back to our homes. Our children being our greatest asset. And homes in America are broken and dysfunctional. And we've accepted that as the normal. I grew up in a blended home. That's the modern word for divorced parents that are remarried, and then maybe some of them remarried again. And I'm not talking about the fact. I realize that marriages end sometimes, and sometimes they're broken, and I understand people getting remarried and all, and God has guidelines and all that. But I'm not even talking about that. I'm just talking about the fact that there's so many homes that let me just say this. If you're here today and you grew up in a home, or if you're here today and you're in a home with your biological mother and father and you grew up your whole life that way, you are a very small minority. And not only the fact of being blended homes, but the fact of homes just shredded and torn and accepted sin, and just anything goes on in the home. Mom and daddy don't put a foot down and don't raise their children according to the precepts of the Word of God. And our homes are just dysfunctional messes. A little religious activity on Sunday for many homes. But it may become normal to America, but it's not normal to God. And God still got a whole Bible full of scriptures on raising children godly and having a godly home and putting a foot down and saying, no, you won't. And saying, I'm the head of this house. Whether it be the daddy in a certain situation or the mom in the right situation in that, but I'm talking about over the children rather than children calling the shots. Under my house, they live by under my roof, they live by my rules. Our church, this health care is good for not only our country, but our children. And our churches, I already mentioned this earlier today, but our churches have lost power. And there's many that have the appearance of power. I don't want to get all into that today. I'm not responsible for them. I don't answer them. But a lot of them got a power promotion, but it ain't necessarily biblical power. But trust me, there's still churches with the power of God that's a biblical power, and come in with a heart of worship and power and a sweet spirit, come in to love to see the brother and all, get there and excited to see each other. But for the most part, churches have lost the power. And we've turned a lot of it from the fault of the pulpit. Turned from preaching the gospel to patting the good. Oh, you're so sweet little Christians. Bless your little hearts. It's okay if you live in that sin. It's okay if you're allowing that sin to go on. It's okay if you do that. God loves you with a big fake smile on your face and billions of dollars in the bank. God have mercy on folks listen to a preacher like that. God have mercy on a preacher like that. But it ain't all the fault of the preacher either. We got our own Bibles. Read your own Bibles. Read, study, pray. Don't depend on me to feed you. Be the only feeding you're going to get. I don't see you, but just a few little bit of time in a week. But you got a Bible all week. Our church has lost the power. We're in a serious power crisis. You know, they talking about making electric cars mandatory and all that, but we ain't got enough power power all them electric cars. They're going to be Teslas all over the place sitting there with a gasoline generator charging them batteries up. But the greatest power problem we got in America is the power of God cast aside. And you get talking about the power of God and move of the Holy Spirit and yielding to the Holy Spirit and worship in truth and spirit. A lot of folks don't even know what you're talking about. God, some benefits of God's health care. Let me move right along here. This health care on a personal level, I'm talking about salvation, Jesus Christ, the great physician there. And he came, he's talking about, he says there in verse 17, they that are whole have no need of the physician, but they that are sick, I came not to call the righteous, but sinners to repentance. And the type he's using of sickness and sinfulness, he's talking about sin sickness. Number one, pre-existing conditions are always accepted. God never called anybody to salvation on the basis that you got to stop doing this, stop doing that, and you clean up and come see me. He's the doctor that specializes in the sinner. If you're here today and you say, well, you don't know what I've done, preacher. You don't know where I've been. You don't know what I've life I've lived and all that. You know what? I don't know. It don't matter. It's none of my business. I don't want to know. I don't need to know. But God already knows it. And knowing that, He gave His only begotten Son to bear our sin, to pay that sin debt. Knowing that, He commended His love toward us while we were yet sinners. Christ died for us. You know, it's a... in this new health care laws and all this stuff, I found this out. We talked to a lady about insurance, and I said something about pre-existing conditions and started mentioning some things that I had in problem. She said, whoa, hush. She said, it's illegal for me to ask you about a pre-existing condition if it's a health care policy that's part of the plan or network, whatever they call it. They can't even ask you about that. We're used to that. Made you not qualified for insurance or your rates would be sky high through the roof. But you know what? God already knows the pre-existing conditions. It's called sin. Some, and I don't argue with me on this, don't take this to task. Some worse than others. Some lived a pretty good life, raised up in church, and I never did a whole lot of bad stuff and all that, but still a sinner on the way to hell. And then some, man, rough, I'm talking about stole stuff, killed folks, just done all kind of stuff. God died, Jesus died. It was right both ways, but Jesus died for both cases. He specializes in it. Pre-existing conditions are always accepted. And I like this. Number two, the price is affordable to all. Man, whoo, that health insurance is expensive. If you've got a job that pays your insurance or you got retirement's got it, please be very, very thankful. Don't take it for granted. Because for self-employed and folks that had to pay for it and such as that, it's ridiculous. It's crazy. Heard somebody that has all the later in life type insurance and they're talking about just the supplements and stuff, and a lot of y'all know what I'm talking about. That stuff's just crazy expensive, man. You spend every penny you got on premiums. But you know what? This sickness care that we've got here, this sin sickness care, price is affordable at all. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. You know, it costs you to exercise faith, trust in him, realizing he died for your sin. And number three and lastly, you go to doctor. How many of y'all ever went to the doctor and he was out with another patient or had to go and couldn't be there and you had to reschedule after you've driven to the doctor's office? That ever happened? Or if that hadn't happened, I know you've been and you got there and you had to wait 4 hours. Shame on me. She's been on the delivery table, didn't have a baby, and somebody else have a more urgent need across town. Doctor had to go deliver that baby, had to push the hold button on her, and that may have happened to some of y'all and all because the doctor had to go do something else and had to wait, you know, and stop pushing. I better stop there while I had. But I said weeds on the table. Ooh, what a dangerous thing for me to say. I'm sorry, baby. But I had to wait for the doctor to get there. Stop, Michael. Hold on. We'll get you later. But Dr. Jesus, this physician, the great physician, always available. My daddy's always on time. His time, perfect time. We don't see as perfect when we feel like he's delayed, but usually pretty soon after he does the work that we're seeking him for, usually we realize if he'd have showed up when I first thought he needed to, all this wouldn't have worked out the way it did. But when we let him work and trust him, and I'm still Mr. Impatient, so I'm preaching to me today and hope that's helped all y'all. He's always available. I just want to say this. If you're here today and do not know Jesus Christ, your Savior, if you've never been truly born again, Christ wants to save you. He's died. He's paid your price. And his desire is not willing that any should perish, but all should come to repentance. Won't you trust him today? Real quickly, if you just play through one song, I mean a verse of a song, if there's anybody here, and I say real quickly, I meant like let's get started quickly, but I'm not in a hurry about invitation time. If you're here today and you don't understand, if you're lost and you need to talk to him, I'm not in a hurry concerning that. But if you're here today and don't know Christ, maybe you need Dr. Jesus to hear your case today. If you're lost and you'll try trust him, realizing he paid your sin debt on old bloody Calvary, he'll save you today. Maybe I hadn't said anything within miles of what's in your heart today. Why don't you bring it to the old-fashioned altar and say, God, help me. Give me strength. Whatever it might be. Father, I pray that you have your way in this time of invitation. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Appreciate you. In the water, but I'm going to dismiss myself, go get ready, and those that are working with the little ones, bring them up. If y'all come on, get them ready. Brother Charles, you'll come lead them in some good songs.
Get a song book and turn to page 79.
Life and atonement for sin,
can open the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receive. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done. Great things He has taught us, great things He hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be our wonder, our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, the earth hear His voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give Him the glory, great things He hath done.
Oops.
Wait a minute.
They're not ready, brother. You wait a minute.
Okay, victory in Jesus. I heard an old story, how a Savior came from glory, how He gave His life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. His precious blood's atoning. Then I repented of my sins and won the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He loved me revealing how He made the lame to walk again and caused the blind to see. And then I cried, dear Jesus, come and heal my broken spirit. And somehow Jesus came and brought to me the victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sought me and He bought me with His redeeming blood. He plunged me in, I knew Him, and all my love is due Him. He plunged me to victory.
expression of an inward experience. Baptism, believer's baptism, is one of the two ordinances of the local New Testament church, the other being the Lord's Supper, or communion, we call it. When a person trusts Christ in salvation, they identify with Jesus in his death, burial, and resurrection. We, at the moment of salvation, spiritually speaking, we're crucified with Christ, buried to self in the old man, and raised alive in Christ, a new creature, the Bible says. Believer's baptism is a picture of that that's taking place in our heart and taking place with Christ at the cross of Calvary. It symbolizes Jesus and identifies with his burial in the likeness of his death and raised in likeness of his resurrection. Romans 6:3 says, "Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Jesus Christ were baptized into his death." And that's talking about spiritual baptism and salvation. "Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in the newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall also in the likeness of his resurrection." And believer's baptism is a picture of that that's taking place. So first of all, we've got Emily Peacock. Change the order. Steffi, come on. Oh, let me swap this. You're too tall for that. We stand way up out of the door again. Step back. This is Steffi Richardson. This is special. I don't want to refer to her as a bus kid, but she does. She rides on a van and has for several years. Most of y'all know Steffi better than I do, but I know since I've been around, has desired to be baptized. She got saved, I'm not sure how long ago, but a pretty good while back. And she's asked me about baptizing her several times. I've talked to her grandmother a while back, so it's my fault that I hadn't baptized her earlier. But we're here today, and we're going to baptize her. So Steffi, have you trusted Christ your Savior and trust him to forgive you of your sins? Amen. Steffi, based on your profession of faith, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Well, Emily's going to wait. She's a little bit fearful of the moment and all that, and I understand that and all. But, Steffi, I'm so glad you got baptized. I look forward to baptizing. We got three others in line and maybe some others that's never been obedient to the Lord in believer's baptism. So maybe we can fill this pool back up and do this again. I thank everybody that came today because of this occasion. I'm thankful for every single soul that's here today. Appreciate you being here today. Brother Bob, how about if you dismiss us in a word of prayer, please?
Father, we thank you that we can be here today as a witness to baptism. These young ones that have accepted Christ as Savior, Lord. We pray that you will be with them, bless them, guide them through their lives, that they might be living examples of Christ to those they meet in their daily lives, so they may serve you whichever way that you would lead them to do.
God's children said? Amen. Amen. Shake hands with one another. That concludes this morning's service. See y'all at 6 o'clock this evening.